I'd like to welcome everybody to the College of Complexes tonight. My name is Tim Brown. I'll be taking over to moderate after a while. Our speaker wants to get up right away, so let's...
Gathered here tonight to hear Elizabeth Corrado, who will be telling us a good deal about energy and its uses and how to use it wisely. I don't know much about Elizabeth. This is my first encounter with her. But she will introduce herself and tell us all about this. Well, not maybe all about herself, but some things. And you will be glad that you came, I'm sure. Let's see, what else? We've had our announcements. You should know that we have two rules here.
Already covered, Brian.
One is one fool at a time, the rest of us shut up and try to make a head and tail out of all the comments that are going by. What is it?
There's a small amount of locally grown organic spearmint on the table if people want to test it.
Oh. Yeah, but don't feel bad about it because I...
Spearmint?
Yes.
Oh, there.
I've got one more announcement.
Yes, another announcement.
What happened to my flyers?
Over on the other table, Charlie.
Oh, you've got programs.
If you want to bring an end to war on Earth, Brad Little, who some of you may know is a regular at the college here, and you Hyde Parkers, he's going to be having a thing on August the 6th, the annual thing, gathering at the Henry Moore Sculpture about the anniversary of the nuclear weaponry.
Is that Friday?
Thursday the 6th, 5:30 p.m. Also, I have some new literature, new brochures we got from the War Resisters League. If you haven't, this is the website, and sign up, it's free. Anyhow, there's literature on the event this Thursday.
Okay. All right. The other rule is that we do not insult anybody personally here. We are civil about their parentage.
We've covered the
fisticuffs. All right. After our speaker has presented her topic and we open to your questions, which is followed by your comments, your rebuttals, and of course our speaker has the final rebuttal to sum up before we hit the road. Without further ado, we have our speaker.
I'm wondering, can I take the microphone or I can just project my voice?
Just use the microphone. You're going to be up front?
Yeah, am I able to do that?
This is going on the internet.
Yeah, you can. I'll adjust.
Sorry about that. Or I could... I just want to be able to sort of see
the
slides.
Take it out of the machine.
How's that?
That's great. Thank you. All right, so thank you very much. Sorry, that's a little bit too loud.
It's all right.
So I'm really glad to be here tonight. My name is Elizabeth Corrado. I work for the nonprofit organization Elevate Energy. We are a spin-off of the Center for Neighborhood Technology. By a show of hands, who has heard of the Center for Neighborhood Technology? Great, okay. So we focus on energy efficiency programs, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. Whenever you're ready, next slide, please. Great. So what I'm going to talk about tonight is I'll tell you a little bit about the nonprofit that I work with. We're going to talk about home energy efficiency, the smart grid and smart meters, the Clean Air Act, and the Clean Jobs Coalition, and then move into questions and answers. Fortunately, I'm going to need to scoot out a little bit early tonight. I had a business trip that got extended down to Central Illinois, and I just got back this afternoon, and I'm feeling pretty wilted. But I'm really glad to be here tonight, and I'm sorry that I'll need to scoot out a little bit early. It sounds like we have plenty of folks who are more than qualified to give a final rebuttal in support of energy efficiency and renewable energy. So what I've passed around to this side of the room, and I'm about to pass around to this side of the room, is a little sort of exit questionnaire. Because we are grant funded, our funders need to see that we're actually out there doing educational programs. So that's what that little half sheet serves as. It has a place for your contact information, and if you're interested in any of the things that I talk about, you can mark that on the little exit ticket, but you certainly don't need to leave your personal information. I would appreciate it if you would fill in the questions that are on there for our funders, though.
I'll pass those out and I'll collect them and make sure you scan the copies.
Thanks a lot.
Ask me the questions I told you about.
All right, if you would move to the next slide, please. And actually, if you could just tap through. Okay, great. So our nonprofit is dedicated to smarter energy use for all. We are both a think and a do tank. So we design and then implement energy efficiency programs. And we have three goals. We want to cut costs, protect our environment, and ensure that the benefits of energy efficiency reach everybody. If you wouldn't mind passing around those little exit tickets, that would be great. Would you send around those half sheets, please, and the pens just around the table? Thank you very much. All right, so I started working for Elevate Energy after I finished my master's in urban planning. And the reason why I got involved is because I am interested in strategies for keeping our housing stock affordable in the long term. Energy efficiency is one, it's not the only one, but it's one of many solutions to help keep our housing stock affordable. So that's how I got involved. All right, next slide, please. Okay, great. So this is my first question for all of you. Where does the bulk of energy loss in our homes come from?
Is that heating energy?
Heating energy, yeah, sure. So where is that heating energy being lost in the winter?
The roof.
Where else?
Walls and windows.
I hear walls and windows. Where else?
It's gotta go up. She has to go
sideways. So Charles is right. If you hit the next slide, please. Almost 70% of energy loss in the average house happens through the attic and the basement. This is because, like Charles just said, hot air rises. So in the wintertime, when we're heating our homes, that hot air rises up and it escapes through our attics and our roofs. And in the summertime, a similar but reverse process happens. This is called the stack effect. Who's surprised that windows only count for about 10% of energy loss in the average home? I found this very surprising when I started working for Elevate. So this is a problem. What is the solution, though? How do you address energy loss happening through the attic and the basement?
Insulation.
How else?
Put windows in your attic.
Living in the attic.
not a recommended solution. Or you know, it could be a solution, but you're gonna have to take some other actions as well. So
ceiling fans,
okay.
You plug the leaks.
Yeah. That's exactly right. So this is on those little exit quizzes, but there's really two main things that we can do to address the problem of energy loss in our homes. It's adding insulation and it's doing air sealing. Not sealing like the ceiling above us, but plugging up leaks and cracks. All right. So this is sort of just a visual of the stack effect and why our hot air is rising up and escaping through the attic in the winter and sort of reverse process in the summer. So as a nonprofit, we have a lot of different programs. We work with other nonprofits and churches and things like that to make their structures more energy efficient. We work with the owners of large apartment complexes to make their buildings more energy efficient. And we also work with small 2 to 4 unit building owners and single family homes, which is what I'm going to talk about. This is not an area that there's been a lot of successful movement on in the U.S., single family homes and how we spread the word on ways that we can make our homes more energy efficient. And so this is a problem that we're trying to tackle. My role is to be an advocate and an educator in the community. All right. So we've come up with a program called Energy Impact Illinois. And what it is it's a program that to help homeowners lower energy loss by 15% or more. Any ideas why 15% or more? Yeah.
Most homeowners I know are real cheapskates and they don't want to insulate or spend any money on what they're doing anyway. They'd rather pay the high energy bills.
So the reason why we're trying to shoot for 15% or more is because that's where a lot of the low-hanging fruit is. That's where we see a high return on investment for energy efficiency improvements. So doing air sealing and insulation usually pays off and then it's just pure money in your pocket within about 10 years. Windows takes a lot longer than that. So we're looking for the lowest hanging fruit with the highest return on investment. There's no income requirements for the program, and like I mentioned before, it's a program for single family homes or 2 to 4 unit buildings.
I'm sorry, let me...
No, that's great, that's perfect. So there are incentives available through the utilities to do air sealing and insulation in our homes. Anybody know where that utility money comes from and why it exists? These rebates for insulation and air sealing. Any ideas?
No, it comes from our monthly
bill. Yes, exactly. So there's a charge on our monthly bills. That money gets pulled into a big pot and we can tap back into it to make improvements. So there's up to $300 available for doing insulation and up to $400 available for doing air sealing.
Is that even if you do the work yourself?
No, so you do have to go through an approved contractor. That's a great segue, so that's actually what I'm going to talk about right now. So what we've done is we have partnered up with contractors who are Building Performance Institute certified. What that means is that they are able to tell you what's wrong and how to fix it, and then actually to fix the problem. Okay, and if you could hit once more, please. Twice more. Okay, great. So usually, during an energy assessment, what happens is a contractor comes out to look at the house. They do a visual inspection and they use an infrared camera. Who's used an infrared camera before? Okay, so it's a really neat tool, and what it does is it shows heat differential. If you point it at the ceiling and there's a strip of insulation that's missing, you're able to see that using the infrared camera and not just with the naked eye. So what a contractor does is they walk around with the infrared camera, do a visual inspection. They do something called a combustion safety test. and that's to check that combustible appliances like the furnace and other combustible appliances are venting properly. Then finally, they run something called a blower door test. Has anybody heard of a blower door test?
Yeah.
What does it do?
Air leaks.
Yeah, so it highlights air leaks.
Yeah.
And it's a way to get a scientific measure of how leaky a home is. So you can see it in the picture down, down below. Basically what it is a big fan that creates a negative pressure in the house. It's connected to a little computer, which I think you can see in that picture. And it has the rate of air exchange. So our homes need some amount of air exchange or else we'd have issues with mold and health. But most of them have far more leakiness than they actually need. So this is the way to get a scientific measure of where your home is at. So usually when contractors do an assessment like this, they charge between $400 and $800, which it's worth, but it creates a high barrier to entry. As a nonprofit, we have tried to figure out how do we get folks to understand what's going on in their homes and to take action. And so one of the ways we found is that education leads to action. So we've partnered up with contractors to do either $99 or free energy assessments instead of charging $400, $500, $600 to do them. Because when we understand what's going on and what money's available to take action, we tend to go forward with work. The free energy assessment is done as a part of a energy impact house party, which, who's familiar with the house party model? This is something that's been used in politics and community organizing for a long time. Great, okay. So basically how it works is you have over 5 or 10 other homeowners, friends, colleagues, family members, to learn about energy efficiency and see the most interesting parts of the energy assessment. Play with the infrared camera, see the blower door, that kind of thing. Just kind of to give you a side note, we as an organization were trying to figure out how to get single family homeowners to take action on energy efficiency. And a big ad campaign was tried with 2 Second City actors. It was actually an award-winning campaign. Any idea how many people did weatherization work after a year of seeing that ad? Just guess, numbers wise.
Less than 5%.
7.
Yeah. Who said 7?
Charlie.
Yeah, Charlie. So it's probably about 7. Very, very few people did anything. So that's when we switched to a community education-based model. And the house parties are part of that model. Since then, we've worked with contractors and homeowners to do over 4,000 retrofits. So we know that the community-based model is very successful. All right. So after an assessment, a contractor sends a report with recommendations for improvement. And then our organization provides contractor oversight and quality control. So we make sure that if a contractor makes a mistake, they go back and fix it. We make sure that, you know, if there's a high bid, we figure out why it's high or, you know, have contractors adjust it, things like that. Okay, so why should we take action on energy efficiency in our homes? First of all, it saves us money. So to give you an idea, to cut our energy loss by 15%, usually is a project cost between $2,500 and $4,000. The average annual savings is $400. So in terms of return on investment for things that we can do in our homes, this is really the best thing that you could possibly do. Perhaps more important is it makes us comfortable. Finally, there's a good indication that energy efficiency improvements that are certified or marked can boost the value of our homes. So who has an Energy Star appliance in this room? Who has seen an Energy Star appliance? Okay, so there's something called the Illinois Home Performance Certificate with Energy Star. And if you would go to the next slide, I'm going to pass around an example of this as well so you can look at it up close.
those assessments make that phone?
So what this is a certificate that gets attached to your house when you reduce energy loss by 15% or more. So it's a relative measure of energy efficiency. There's a special checkbox for this certificate on the multiple listing service that realtors use in the Chicagoland area to market and sell homes. There haven't been studies done on this particular certificate, but studies have been done on similar certificates in California showing a 9% price premium for homes that had a green certification attached to them. So that's a good indication that energy efficiency is valued in the housing market. All right. Thank you. So I'm going to transition from talking about our homes to talking about community and statewide infrastructure, particularly our switch to a smart grid and smart meters. Who has heard about the smart grid? Okay, great. Who has a new smart meter? Okay, good. So how long has it been since our electrical grid, which is the lines, wires, distribution centers, meters, all of that has been upgraded? How long has it been?
Probably
40 years.
Longer.
60.
About 100. It's actually never really been updated in a meaningful way. So we are way overdue for an upgrade to our electrical grid. What happens right now when we have an outage? So you try to turn the light and it doesn't turn on. What happens next?
Electric companies call and they fix a line.
They call? Do they call you?
No.
You call them. So everybody calls them, and then what do they do next?
They go out and they fix a line to find out where they go.
Okay, so they have to find out where the outage is. They actually send staffers out in trucks to try to pinpoint the outage, and then they can fix it.
Now they have fiber optic network and the cables that'll do that.
So with the new smart grid, they're actually going to be able to pinpoint outages on the computer and fix them faster.
They actually do it now.
So in addition to being able to fix outages faster, they're going to be able to prevent some outages from happening. Does anybody know how?
Almost ready.
Your grid will be made overall more reliable.
Yes.
For a variety of reasons. So
yes.
Overall reliability will increase.
Yeah, and one of the reasons why is because when they have an outage happen, they can often flip a switch to reroute power. So to give a sort of crude example, if we have our electricity coming from the east and we have an outage on the east side, they can flip a switch and start pumping it from the west. So it's not going to get rid of outages, but it is sort of a way of responding to and shortening or preventing outages. Another benefit to the smart grid, and these are on your little exit tickets as well, is reducing energy waste. And this comes from the utility's ability to pinpoint things like abandoned buildings and shut off the flow of electricity that's been going out to them. Okay. Part of the new electrical grid is getting new meters, what we call smart meters. These have a digital face on them. So that's how you'll know that you have one. Your meter number should also start with a 2 on your bill if you have a smart meter that's been installed. And what the new meters do is they're going to give us more power over our power and options about what kind of pricing plans we have for our electricity. So right now, most of us are on a flat rate. Doesn't matter whether we do our dishwasher and our washing machine at 2 p.m. or at 9 p.m. on a Tuesday or on a Saturday. We pay the same amount for that volume of electricity. The smart meters make it easy to pay not just by how much electricity we use, but also by when we use it. So there's a potential financial benefit as well as a potential environmental benefit, which I'll talk about in a minute. So just by show of hands, who does their heavy electrical use during the day, let's say 9 to 6 p.m. Okay, depends. I see some hands. Who does it usually in the evening or the early morning or the weekend? Couple people. Okay. When are peak times, do you think, when everybody wants to use electricity all at once?
Prime time.
When's prime? When is that?
When the best shows are on TV.
Oh. 10 p.m.?
7 to 10.
7 to 10. Other ideas?
Yes. 3 o'clock in the afternoon with office buildings.
3 o'clock? Summertime? So it is actually the peakest times would be hot summer afternoons. In general, electricity is cheaper in the early mornings, the evenings, and on the weekends. This does have a lot to do with business and industry as opposed to residential use. So it's not so much about us going home, making dinner, and turning on the television. It's more about when the business and industry are up and running. So there's a couple of different programs that I'm going to talk about. Hourly pricing is a program where you pay the market rate for electricity. And actually, if you would go to the next slide, that would be great. Thank you. So in hourly pricing, you're paying a fluctuating rate. It's generally cheaper in the early mornings, the evenings, and the weekends, but there are some fluctuations. So I have an example on here. It's kind of a little bit hard to see, but it's about 7 cents per kilowatt hour on is the Chicago residential price right now. So if you're on a flat rate or you're just paying by volume of electricity, that's what you're paying. In ComEd's real-time residential pricing program, I used an example of 7 a.m. to 8 a.m. this morning. It was, 2.6 cents per kilowatt hour. So that's substantially less. So that's one option. The option on the bottom that I have listed is called time of use. And how that program works is you pay one rate between 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. and a cheaper rate between 7 p.m. and 7 a.m. During peak times, the power plants that are started up to meet that peak demand tend to be the dirtiest, most inefficient ones. It's a matter of quick burn something. So from an environmental perspective, the more that we can shift away from having these peaks and valleys in our electrical usage, the better. We've also seen financial benefits from these programs. So average savings for hourly pricing is about $100 a year.
So you can adjust your smart meter into those three,
Yeah, so these are programs you actually have to enroll in. And the smart meters make it easy to take advantage of these programs. But if you are interested and you don't have your smart meter installed, the utility will actually come out and install an interval meter, what we sometimes refer to as a smart dumb meter. So it has the capability to enable you to take advantage of these programs, but it's not fully capable as a part of the smart grid. That's a great question. If you would just go back a slide, please. I have one more program I want to talk about in this category. There's something called peak time savings, which is recommended across the board for everybody. You do have to have a smart meter for this program. Has anybody heard of it before, peak time savings?
Yes.
Yes, okay, good. How it works is you enroll with ComEd, and they send you an alert 3 to 5 times over the course of the summer saying, today we expect extra heavy usage on the grid. If you can postpone running your vacuum or you can raise your thermostat by 4 degrees, we will put a credit on your bill. It's not a huge credit. It's something like, $8 or something in that ballpark. But it is something. And the nice thing about peak time savings is you're never penalized. So you can sign up for the program and then ignore every alert you get and they'll never charge you for it.
You can cheat.
Cheat?
Yeah.
Well, you wouldn't get the benefit unless you took advantage of the savings event and postponed your usage. And they're comparing it to what you use at other, like your average usage, basically.
I got a question about Pete. So is that because of air conditioning at 3 in the afternoon? Is it the peak usage?
Yeah, so I mean, the highest spikes are going to be hot summer afternoons, and that does have to do with air.
Yeah, but it's only summer 3 months a year.
Right, so during the other times of the year, it's still like daytime and early, you know, evening when there's the heaviest tax usage on the grid. And that has to do with business and industry all year round.
All in the afternoon?
Yeah, during the day and then the afternoon, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so early morning, evening, and weekends are the cheaper times to use if you're signed up for a dynamic pricing program.
I can see the summer that if
you don't know about
the year, it's gonna be all even.
Okay, could you flip, I think one more slide? Okay, great. So that's all I'm gonna say about the smart grid for right now. I wanna talk about the Clean Jobs Coalition. Who's heard of the Clean Jobs Coalition? Charles, no? I'm sure you have. No?
Charles, no.
No? Okay. All right. What about the Federal Clean Air Act?
Yes.
Okay. So part of the Federal Clean Air Act is the stipulation that states need to come up with plans to cut carbon emissions from existing sources. So Illinois needs to create a plan to reduce carbon emissions, as does every other state. Our organization and a variety of other community organizations, businesses, faith groups have banded together to create something called the Clean Jobs Coalition. And what we are is a group that's promoting policy that's going to support clean jobs, renewable energy, and energy efficiency. So energy efficiency is just gonna reduce our demand. Renewable energy is gonna help us to reduce our carbon emissions, and the clean jobs are things that come along with both of those categories. So things like the jobs that are created for contractors when we make our homes more energy efficient, and we access utility incentives and rebates. So if you're interested in the Clean Jobs Coalition, you can leave me a note on the little exit ticket. As our efforts around that ramp up again, we will need folks to do things like write editorials or help us recruit folks for rallies to support those three things. All right, and that is the end. I have my contact information on the next slide, I believe. Oh, I'm sorry, I have a couple of action items, of course, because like I said, we're a think and do tank. So here are some things that you can do if you're interested in what I've talked about. So you can have a home energy assessment done by one of our partner contractors who will come out for $99 and do the energy assessment and give you a report. You can sign up for one of the dynamic pricing programs that I discussed, where you pay not just by how much electricity you use, but also by when you use it. If you're not sure whether you're a good fit for one of those programs, you can mark it down and I'll just give you a follow-up call. You can support the Clean Jobs Coalition, and how you can do that is gonna kind of vary depending on what's going on around the policy, but that might involve calling local elected officials or writing editorials, like I mentioned, things like that. Or you can help us to educate others. So pull together a group of 5 or 10 other homeowners and have a free energy assessment done on your home and help to show people what happens during an energy assessment and also spread the word on the smart grid. So with that, I have my contact information on the last slide, I think. Great. And I understand we'll transition into questions. Is that right?
Yes, that's correct.
Great. Yes. Sorry.
That's all right. Go ahead and start.
Yeah. All right, let's thank her.
Let's thank her.
Yeah.
Do you think electricity should be, electric wires should be on poles or should they be underground?
That's a great question, and I know that there's a lot has to go into that in terms of cost and reliability. So I don't think that I can answer that, but I think it's a great question. Yeah.
Does your organization have anything to do with the Green Party?
Huh? We're not affiliated with any political organization.
I'll get you that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is a great presentation. Let's envision that we have an entirely updated and modernized smart electricity grid. What would the electrical utilities look like? How would they change? And what kind of energy efficiency programs would we have?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I guess I have a couple different remarks. So I think one of the neat things about the smart grid is it should enable us, those of us who want to generate our own electricity, so if we want to put solar panels on our home, we should be able to connect back into the grid and sell that electricity back. From another angle, things like electric vehicles and the dynamic pricing programs that are enabled by the smart grid go hand in hand. So it's going to be really cheap and easy to charge our electric vehicles overnight when the price of electricity is very low on these dynamic pricing programs, and also when it has less of an environmental impact. So there's gonna be other changes as well. So, you know, we're not gonna have meter readers walking around to read meters, although we're still gonna have people interpreting the data, but just from the other side of the computer now. That's one of the other shifts, yeah.
I might have missed this. So when we talk about a smart grid, are we talking about smart meters, or are we talking about other infrastructures?
Yeah, so it's all of the infrastructure. I focus on the meters because that's where we really have control.
Is there anything else that you know of that makes it a smart grid, or I couldn't deal with that stuff?
Yeah, I mean, they're updating the technology that's used they're updating the lines and wires in the distribution centers, putting in things like those switches that I referenced where you can reroute the power
right.
to respond to outages. The smart meters are gonna help them to be able to pinpoint the outages. So yeah, it's a full upgrade of not just the meters, but all of them.
You know, I would think solar panels are already going back to the grid here, or are we behind in that? Is Illinois allowing somebody if you had a panel on the roof here, could it go back into the grid, or are we like, you know, they don't have that figured out yet?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know. I'm not sure to what extent right now.
I think California does that.
Yeah. I know that's part of the promise of the smart grid is that we're going to be able to easily connect in our sort of dispersed generation and sell it back. But I don't know what the status is right now.
Is there any money available for things like upgrading heating and air conditioning equipment and like programmable thermostats?
Yeah, so the contractors that we partner with can provide recommendations for furnaces and things like that. There are also sometimes utility incentives for those things. Peoples actually has a program where they will come out and install a programmable thermostat, put in low flow shower heads, insulated pipe wrap, things like that for free. So that's available.
I still love thermostats connected to your smartphone.
Okay, I have a couple questions. First of all, a few days ago, I received a mailing from ComEd saying that you can sign up for getting all your electricity from clean power sources, and that the first month or two would be a fixed rate, and after that it would be variable. What do you think about that program?
That's a great question. So a little bit of background information. Not too long ago, the market for the supply of our electricity was deregulated. So there's kind of two different, we can think of our electricity like there's the lines and wires and all of that. That's what ComEd provides. That's where ComEd makes their profit.
There's also the electricity, like the juice itself, that goes through those wires. ComEd is not allowed to make any profit off of that. And the market for that juice or that supply was deregulated. So you do have these little companies competing for your business.
Are they scams or are they legit?
Right, so that's the million-dollar question, right? So the things that they offer vary in terms of quality. There are some, this letter that's going around, they might mention ComEd. I would, you know, it may be another supplier who is mentioning ComEd in a way that's sort of unclear and makes it sound like it's ComEd sending it.
Something like that, yeah.
So generally the best deals happen through municipal aggregation where cities work out agreements with different providers. Or through the dynamic pricing programs. Sometimes the alternative suppliers can offer good deals too, but you want to watch out for exactly what you mentioned, the variable rate. So if it has a variable rate, you know, stay away. And if there's an exit fee. So some of them, you know, you can sign up for, but are they going to penalize you for leaving?
Yeah, I mean, it said that, it said that there wasn't a penalty for leaving, but it said that they're not going to say what the rate is going to be after the first month or two or something.
Yeah, stay away from variable rate options. And to get a full comparison of different rate options, you can go on the Citizens Utility Board website. We often partner with them. They have great information. Or I think Plug-in Illinois also has some information. You can also call us. We have a call center. People are able to answer questions about different offers and options that are on the table. Yeah?
Yeah, what's the status of the Clean Jobs Bill that was introduced in Springfield?
Yeah, I don't think there's any updates right now. I think we're kind of on a hiatus right now.
Yeah, but people may want to know what that is and what happened to it and everything. That's
I'm not really sure, and because we are a nonprofit, we focus on the issues themselves and then stay sort of an arm's length away from the actual political jockeying.
Because Exelon admitted, I'm vice president of NEIS, and I'm going to address that in a rebuttal. Exelon admitted that they didn't get enough votes to pass their nuclear bailout bill, which is a kind of a competing thing with the Clean Jobs Act.
Yeah, so we're kind of on a hiatus right now with that, yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
Well, I'm just wondering, I don't really understand, why is it better to not use electricity during peak time? Does that, when you use it during non-peak time, does that increase efficiency of the electrical output? I don't really understand.
Yeah, so that's a good question. So,
want me to go to
it's, I'm trying to think of how to explain this. So there's really the two reasons. So we think about it when we need to meet peak demand. So, you know, if you have two people in this room, running the vacuum, okay, you know, you have a certain amount of, you know, you have power plants started up that are stable. Now suddenly everybody else in this room turns on their vacuum. Okay, we got a quick meet that demand. We're going to start up the oldest, most inefficient power plants, burn things quick. So that's not fiscally or environmentally sustainable. And the savings that are associated with not having to suddenly meet that peak demand are passed on to the consumer in the dynamic pricing program.
Well, so you're saying like the less people are using it, the electricity, they can use like cleaner, smarter facilities.
Yeah, for better. Yeah. Yeah.
Questions. Have you dealt with condo buildings? And this is a totally different story than you trying to seal your roof.
Yeah. So we have done a lot with apartment buildings. And I actually jotted down the numbers over here. So I will say condo buildings are tricky because in apartment buildings, which structurally are the same, you deal with the whole thing as one unit. So it could be an 8 apartment building or an 8 condo building, and you approach it as one structure, one envelope. And there's a lot of decision makers within a condo building versus in an apartment building, you have one owner and one decision maker. But we've done over 23,000 apartments. And I meant to mention this earlier, but since I'm on the topic, I wrote down the equivalency in terms of metric tons of CO2 saved, which is about 44,000, which is the equivalent of how many passenger cars off the road. Anybody know? A little bit over 9,000, so about 9,300 passenger vehicles taken off the road in terms of equivalency of CO2 saved. But to get back to your question, so we do sometimes work with condo buildings. It's just a matter of getting the buy-in from all of the decision makers on the condo board and condo association and things like that. And we treat the whole building as one single envelope due to the top and the bottom. Yeah.
Seems like your whole game plan would not be beneficial to senior citizens who spend a great deal of time at home. So if you're a senior citizen, they should tell you to get lost, right?
And we do. I mean, we don't tell you to get lost.
Their energy is basically 24 hours.
Right. So if you're somebody who's at home during the day, and what would happen is if you check the box that you're interested in signing up for a dynamic pricing program, that's one of the questions I would ask you when I called you, and then we would not enroll you. So we do a screening process because not everybody is a good fit. You know, if you're at home during the day, or if you have to be doing a certain heavy electrical activity every day at a peak time, or if you have medical equipment that's always on, it's not a good fit.
Follow up, what are the worst appliances? Isn't these televisions about the worst for using electricity?
Not anymore.
Offhand?
That's a good question. I'm not sure.
It used to be, I thought. Color television was the worst.
I'm not sure.
It used to be color TV until they had the LED flat screens come in. They're a lot less use of energy now than they did with the old tube TVs.
Okay.
And you'll find that most of your consumer appliances today are made with that Energy Star label on the back of it. And you'll find that the basic consumer electronics, you're cheaper now having 5 LED TVs in your home than you would when you had the old tube TV running all the time. They don't, they don't, not as much. They can.
Okay. Any other questions?
Big screens.
Yes.
I have a problem turning off my old TV. I can only use the remote control. Somehow the button, the off button, does not work anymore.
Well, don't lose that remote control, right?
Yeah, well, even when it's off, it's really on.
Oh, really? Oh, are you talking about phantom electricity in terms of what's being pulled out of the, through wires, even when it's off but plugged in? Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
How does this program compare with, say, demand billing for business?
Demand billing? Oh, demand billing.
Where businesses are built for cheap uses of power.
Yeah, so the hourly pricing program, the dynamic pricing program that I talked about, I mean, it's the equivalent for residents of what businesses have seen for a long time in terms of the option to pay by peak and non-peak time. I believe that it is.
I don't think it is, but I could be wrong.
Okay. I'll have to double check on that, but I certainly in certain parts of the state, that's been an option.
We're being told then that we're saving money by not using peak times. But actually, it's the delivery system that is getting the break. We are being charged the full rate, and they're getting a break because of their investment in smart meters.
So right, couple of things. The savings that come from using it non-peak times are only happen if you sign up for the dynamic pricing program. And the other thing is, it is important to make sure that we as consumers see the benefits of smart grid technology, which is why, as a part of the Smart Grid Modernization Act, the requirement was in place that nonprofits like us and the Citizens Utility Board were funded to make sure that people understand what they can do with the smart meters, like the dynamic pricing programs, because we want to make sure that consumers see the benefits. Yeah?
You know what I'm having a hard time understanding, and it has to do with the question about, you know, I get stuff in the mail for renewable, sustainable electricity. So you got all these generation plants, you got coal, you got nuclear, you got Midwest Generation, you got all these window farms downstate, you got waterfalls, you got people putting stuff into the grid. It all this electricity, your juice as you call it, goes into the grid. So how can you quantify, so how can somebody send something to me in the mail from Washington, D.C. and say, if you sign up with me, we guarantee 100% that you're going to be getting windmill electricity through your ComEd line.
Right.
How do they guarantee? They can't guarantee
right.
that.
Right. No, you're absolutely right. That is impossible. That's not how electricity works at all.
That's how they're going to look.
Yeah. What it means, though, is that you have paid for a certain amount of renewably generated electricity to be put onto the grid, and you're not going to be the one getting it, but somebody's going to get it somewhere, and you've paid for that quantity to go onto the grid.
Oh, is that the thing?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
It's okay.
Yeah, it's a good question.
Let me think about that.
Yeah.
Okay, so what's the name of your organization again?
Elevate Energy.
Okay. So we can go on your website or call the hotline number and learn about our different options?
Yeah, you can. I mean, the best thing to do is I'm going to collect the little exit tickets with the questions on them. And if you're interested in something, just let me know. And what I'll do is I'll give you a phone call, or if you want, I'll give you an email and follow up with you, and we can talk about how it works.
Do you... You know, it's been said with the smart grid that it's going to cost a lot more, up to $2 to $4 billion, to upgrade the smart grid with all this new technology. And when I look myself at renewable energy, and it's supposedly going to, you know, be this utopia coming in here, I just don't see it being enough power. What is Elevate Energy's position on things like nuclear and large-scale power plants and things along these lines? Or do you have one?
I think that's a great question. And I don't know. I'm not sure what the position is or what the qualifiers around the position are.
How about your own views then, if you don't mind me asking? Or do you, if you don't care to comment, that's fine. I'm just curious.
I think I'm going to pass, so that's okay.
Okay, that's fine.
not because I have something, you know, super scandalous that I would be saying, but because I don't want to mix the two together.
Okay.
So.
a little bit more about your personal background. We're just kind of curious about how you came to work for this group.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe what led you into the field a little bit more, just a little bit
of
your life path and how you found the job at Elevate Energy.
Sure. So I did a master's in urban planning. My focus was on community development for social justice. I was down at the University of Illinois at Champaign-Urbana. And I did a research exchange in the Netherlands. Made a friend who was working for CNT Energy. After we graduated, and that's sort of how I got hooked into the organization. In addition to housing affordability, I really appreciate and stand behind the idea that energy efficiency needs to be beneficial to everybody, not just the wealthy, not just the urban, but everyone needs to see the benefits of energy efficiency. So that's one of the things that I really liked about our organization, and that got me involved and has kept me involved.
Dutch use a lot of windmills for electricity?
Oh, yeah.
What percentage of their juice is?
I don't know, but yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a fascinating place to study. It's really wonderful.
Why don't you price things out where the biggest users get the highest rates? So if I'm a skimpy user, like my bill would go from 50 to $20. Somebody's got big screens on all over the house. Charge them more for what?
You know, I pay attention to our electric bill.
Sure. Yeah.
And I would say it's a 60-40 split between the cost of energy and the cost of delivery plus taxes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like I could save 20% on my cost of energy, and it would take 5% off of my bill.
Mm-hmm.
Because most of my bill is delivery and taxes.
Yeah.
You know, so I don't see why, in our case, we use very little energy, pull all the vampires off and
stuff.
Yeah, I don't see the investment paying off in my lifetime.
Yeah, no incentive.
For saving energy, one, don't use a lot, and two, when it makes up such a small portion of your bill.
Thank you.
The actual cost of electricity makes up maybe 40% of the cost of delivering electricity to you.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, the average savings is about $100, so it's not enormous.
A year?
Yeah, mm-hmm. But it's a little something, you know, that's enough to go out and do something fun or, you know, put away for savings, so it's something.
Okay.
Yeah.
What kind of fun can you have for $100?
Yeah.
Come to the college, Charlie. It's plenty fun.
I don't know if you're involved with this, but like, how do you get, you know, landlords seem completely disinterested in weatherizing their buildings. And I know a lot of the carbon footprint comes from inefficient buildings. So what do you think about this problem? I mean, all of the landlords I've had, almost all have been like, well, you know, we don't want to replace the windows, we don't want to blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, so I think that's a great question. So it's easier, of course, with landlords that pay for the heat in their buildings. So when there's heat in common, and if they're paying the bill for the whole building, that's sort of it's a pretty compelling motivation to make things more efficient. I think that the issue of retaining tenants is important too. So having a building that feels comfortable, where bills are lower even when you know, the landlord's not the one paying the actual bill. I think this issue of tenant retention can come into play. But it can be tricky sometimes. You know, it's not always easy to convince a landlord to go ahead and do things to their buildings.
Right here on the website.
I assume they get like a tax break for doing that.
I don't know if there's a tax break, but landlords of like small buildings can still access the utility incentives that I talked about for doing air sealing and insulation. So those are available.
A number of presidential candidates have suggested as part of their platform eliminating the Department of Energy altogether, having no useful purpose. What do you feel about this? Do we have a state Department of Energy?
Sorry, what was that?
What? Do we have anything in the city or state that's a comparable?
I don't know.
The Citizens Utility Board.
Yeah, so the Citizens Utility Board is the watchdog on the utilities. I mean, I think that the programs that are available for homeowners to do energy efficiency improvements for everybody, and particularly for low-income folks, those are really, really important investments. And that we need those things. We need more of those things.
Okay. We done with questions?
Well,
yes. One more, I think. Yeah.
I have actually two questions.
David Travis, yes.
My first question is, could an undertaker save money by using a hand crank embalming device instead of an electric one?
Yeah, probably.
My other question is, are there any questions that are not...
Well, I think you answered your own question.
Yeah.
Yeah, Charlie, did you want to wrap us up?
Yeah, I've got one. The President of the United States and the administration is taking the cost of being anti-coal, which results, if you listen to the Congress, and an increase of our energy bills. And which side are you on this issue? I mean, obviously you want, it seems a little odd that I'm supposed to spend all this money and do all this assessment to reduce my energy bills, and then the president is acting, apparently, according to the Republicans, to increase the cost of this energy. It wouldn't be an issue if it wasn't for Obama.
I think, well, regardless of what fuels our energy, we're gonna have to reduce the demand. So regardless of what our source is, we have to reduce our demand first, which is why if you came to me and said, I wanna put solar panels on my house, my first question would be, have you insulated and air sealed? Have you reduced your need for energy first and then stepped to renewable sources? I don't think I'm not familiar enough to say with Obama's particular coal policy.
We have one more questioner, that's Andy Anderson.
Do you have information, have you run across a national program pushed by the EPA called DER, Deep Energy Retrofit? It was written up in Heating and Air Conditioning magazine last year. The program is DER, Deep Energy Retrofit, means fix the walls and windows. They take the siding off a house, put 4 inches of foam board on, put the siding back on, you know, plug the leaks and everything, add another layer of window glass, and eliminate the need for a furnace. They cut the heat load by 90% by fixing the walls and windows. And they get a mortgage payment or something, it'll pay for itself over 7 to 10 years, for existing buildings, getting rid of the need for a furnace altogether.
Interesting. I'm not familiar with that program.
It hasn't been on the news at all.
Well,
I still got a burner.
Thank you very much for having me this evening. It was really nice to talk with you. Thank you for your intelligent questions and conversation. I'm going to just walk around and I'll go ahead and pick up those exit tickets.
All right. Andy, I think that's a memo. And I saw the furniture.
All right.
We got rebuttals.
This is the rebuttal period. And how many of you have some
sort of comments to make here. One, two, three, four. Four? Only four of you have comments.
We'll go 10 minutes, Rob.
Oh,
yeah.
There's a hand.
Yes.
We'll go wait to 10 minutes each.
I might even come up with a comment myself. All right.
Let's 40 minutes each.
All right. How much time do we have?
We got about an hour and 40 minutes. An hour and 25 minutes. It's 7:35.
Oh.
What we'll do is we'll give everybody a 10-minute time frame.
Yes, but you don't have to take out the full 10 minutes. Whatever time you have. Now, let's see. We have three chairs over here. And those of you who are ready, I would suggest that you go over here and wait out your 10 minutes.
Okay. When you're ready, we'll go.
All right, that is Nelson.
Again, thanks, Elizabeth. This weekend is the Lollapalooza Musical Festival in Grant Park. I'm happy to see everybody here tonight for the Efficiency Palooza. That's what I call it.
Yeah.
I'm glad that Charlie scheduled Elevate Energy to speak this evening. It's good for you folks to hear from someone other than myself or Andy Anderson about energy efficiency. Yep. I love your slogan, A Smarter Energy Use for All, because the messaging is terrific. It's a no-brainer that we are energy gluttons, that we are addicted to consuming too much energy. However, this challenge presents the opportunity to present the issue of using a lot less energy in a positive light, to focus upon the positive economic, social, political, and ecological advantages of greatly cutting our energy consumption. Increased energy efficiency is our fastest, cleanest, safest, most secure, and most economical energy resource. My name is Dennis Nelson, and I'm the Vice President of the Nuclear Energy Information Service, NEIS, here in Chicago. At NEIS, we have the slogan, Energy as a Common Sense Matter. Our slogan dovetails your slogan, Elizabeth, to a T. NEIS advocates the full practical use of the best ways to use energy far more efficiently as an integral part of a carbon-free, nuclear-free energy pathway. After I graduated from college with my Bachelor of Science degree in Biology and Environmental Studies in 1976, I read the seminal book, Soft Energy Paths Toward a Durable Peace, by the venerable Amory B. Lovins, who was a physicist with an environmental organization called Friends of the Earth. And here's where I first learned about the great untapped potential for end-use efficiency. The U.S. could at least double its end-use energy efficiency. In particular, Lovins examined the building sector and industrial cogeneration. Just like physicist Arthur Rosenfeld, who's done a lot to promote energy efficiency, including the building sector, and John Holdren, who is now Obama's chief science and technology advisor. Amory B. Lovins was a technologist ahead of his time in promoting increased energy efficiency. For the rest of my time, I'm going to discuss the smart electricity grid. And the best book that I found about this subject is by Dr. Peter Fox Penner. It's entitled Smart Power, Climate Change, the Smart Grid, and the Future of Electric Utilities. The anniversary edition was published last year by Island Press. He defines the smart grid as this, quote, combining time-based prices with the technologies that can be set by users to automatically control their use and self-production, lowering their power costs and offering other benefits such as increased reliability to the system as a whole, unquote. The smart grid will encourage smaller scale local generation, commonly referred to as distributed generation, which is what Elizabeth referred to. Now, there are four main electric technologies that he talks about in distributed generation's future. We have combined heat and power, CHP, or cogeneration plants, also called microturbines or small cogeneration, small wind installations, small PV plants, and fuel cells. Another change brought on by the smart grid will be the greater use of electricity storage, the technologies that allow customers and utilities to communicate and share grid control will easily accommodate storage devices. He refers to the new paradigm. customer control systems responding to prices, smaller local generators, and much greater levels of storage are the three physical landmarks of the downstream smart grid. Now, this is a figurative expression. It's not maybe literal downstream, like from a power plant, and sometimes it is. Like if it's a large hydro plant or a nuclear plant that uses, has to have water to cool its reactor core. He's referring to, you know, you've got upstream, you've got the producers, and then it's a figurative, downstream, you've got the customers, the consumers. And he's referring to, of course, the downstream smart grid. This new technology suite will enable customers to observe and control their electricity use as never before and to participate in keeping the grid balanced. A system that previously flowed power only from large central sources to downstream customers will flow in both directions from locally based generation and storage. New power management systems will respond automatically to hourly prices and utility signals. I wanted to address the point that the gentleman raised about if you pay a premium for green power. In my job search, I've sat in on at least three of these deregulation companies that have come into Chicago since the Illinois State Legislature passed the deregulation bill, and I've heard at least three of their job spiels, and they offer that, and as she said, you know, there's no guarantee, you're just paying a premium, and it goes out on the grid. I'll get back to what the book says. I'll just mention Dr. Peter Fox Penner is a principal and chair of the Brattle Group, a leading economic consulting firm on energy regulatory and market policy issues. Okay. One of the most important features of the smart grid, as what Elizabeth talked about, is that it automatically enables dynamic pricing. You have time varying or time differentiated rates. Demand response is a broader concept which refers to all policies and programs that get customers to shift their use around. I have to disagree with Tim Bolger. I believe that a combination of efficiency, cogeneration, and renewables can supply all of our energy requirements. Now, the book goes into four different scenarios as to what our energy system might look like under a complete smart grid. My favorite is the completely green, because that's what we're moving towards right now. Quote, if all power can't be made at the local level, perhaps it can nevertheless be 100% renewable. And this aggregates larger scale and smaller scale renewable sources, along with distributed energy resources, along with demand response and energy efficiency in a scenario that relies on no new gas, coal, or nuclear power. He mentions a former Vice President Al Gore's Repower America campaign called for this outcome in late 2008. Google's energy team and other researchers have produced more detailed proposals along these lines. I've talked about carbon-free, nuclear-free. The architect is Dr. Arjun Makajani, an engineer and physicist with the Institute for Energy and Environmental Research out of Tacoma Park, Maryland. We also have Mark Jacobson and his research team, and he's an engineer from Stanford University that is basically has reached the same conclusion that we can get all of our power from renewables. I asked the question about the electrical utility industry for a reason, because there are two basic scenarios that he suggests. There's two business and regulatory models that might serve as a sustainable future at the center of a new industry vision. He talks about the smart integrator would be a utility that abandoned retail electric rates and focused on operating a smarter grid. This is the natural path for the parts of the world where retail electric sales are already deregulated. This business model is a natural platform for the integration of the full portfolio of grid edge technologies from small generators to smart devices. However, this model requires a substantial retooling of grid services, pricing, and regulation, and progress in these areas has been slow so far, and that's an understatement. The second model views utilities as full-service providers of energy services, heat, light, computer screen hours, and so on. He calls this business the energy service utility. And this integrates forward into in-home services and technologies that combine with raw kilowatt hours to provide the things we really want from our electricity. This would be a radical departure from the current regulated utility business model, with an even more extensive reworking of pricing and oversight. The role of market-driven grid edge services is more complex and less price-mediated in this model, but is not necessarily less successful. Tim, how much more time do I have?
I'm sorry, I meant to turn the clock around. My apologies.
Half a minute.
It's all right, take another minute if you need it.
Okay, well, I've got a lot here. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that he talks about. Basically, we're talking about combined heat and power by the year 2030 could eliminate the need for 80 to 100 large 1,000 megawatt reactors. And when you're talking about state renewable energy portfolio standards, they mandate roughly 208,000 megawatts of new renewable capacity by 2030. That doesn't even include a federal mandate if that would be put into play. You're talking about being able to replace with renewables the equivalent of 208 large nuclear reactors. So nuclear power is simply unnecessary. Thanks a lot.
No news.
I've heard and I think it's. I'll explain in my rebuttal later on when you're ready.
That's real.
Hey, very interesting subject. You know, as time goes on, I see everything has either got two sides to it, which be a coin. Some things have three sides to them, which is like a triangle. Some things have four sides or squares, and then we got pyramids, and then we have cubes. There's so many sides to things. Well, this one has a lot of sides. In our case, I've learned to pull all of the vampires off of the home, and for some reason we have a very low electric bill, even though we live a normal 20th century or 21st century life. And like I said to the lady before, in my electric bill, two-thirds of it is delivery and taxes. Only a third is the cost of power. So becoming really efficient is never going to pay me in my lifetime. The other side of that coin, though, is global warming, you know, extra CO2 in the air. You know, that's something you'd like to work out. The deal with people's energy who have been upgrading to high pressure gas, doing a really terrible job at it, losing gas all over the place through leaks because of their terrible installations, and for some reason they're still in business and they want to up their utility, their delivery costs, because they're asking the state to upgrade to charge us more for their delivery costs because they're doing such a bad job at delivering, but they still have to cover their overhead, which is very expensive because they're doing such a bad delivery job. Another side of the coin. Interesting is the fellow who does the Tesla cars, Elon is his name, maybe? Elon Musk. He wants to and is working towards delivering home's battery storage units, so that if you were to buy one of these, the proposed price I heard was like $3,500, more or less, for an average home. You just put it in your basement, and then you go onto the smart grid, and you load up with power at night at the 7 cents a level, you know, and just spend it during the day, and at night you do it again. And you know, you're never going to save any money doing that. But, you know, it's not all about saving money. There's a lot of sides to the coin. Some of it is, you know, less CO2 in the air. The nice thing about moving away from coal is that we did it not because of the CO2 it puts out. We did it because natural gas is so cheap. And we didn't do it, it was done to us in a sense. Natural gas, because of fracking, is really, really, really cheap. And those natural gas auxiliary units that they just come in on a truck, they drop them off at the power plant, they hook them up, and if they need a few more megawatts, it's like push the button, fire this thing up, or fire two or three or four of them up, run them on natural gas, and life is good. And that's why coal is being hit hard. It's for no other reason than economics. Not about, and natural gas does produce a lot less carbon than coal does, and a lot less other waste too, because it's just all gas. There's no, you know, what do you call it? There's no residual ash. But the future has to be just more energy efficient, only because we can't burn all the carbon in the ground. Although given a chance, that is exactly what we'll do. And the tricky thing about energy costs, of course, is that as you become more efficient, then the resources we have in the world for, let's say, gasoline, become like we have more abundant gasoline, less use for it, so the price goes down. If the price goes down, why do you want to be more efficient? Because it costs you so much less. Many sides to this coin. This might even be more than a square. It could be like a quadrictetrahedron or something like that. It's a really interesting problem. The problem has like the economic side, which has its own morality, and the save the planet side, which has its own morality. Hard to balance. All right, thank you.
Anderson.
Good evening. Tim's coming back. He's going to reset the clock here. And I promise to be under the allotted time tonight. I'll be quick.
And when you're ready, I'm starting.
Just make a few points that are being broadcast worldwide by the energy efficiency movement. Number one, here's a number that virtually all energy efficiency advocates talk about, 10,000 to 1. It means that 10,000 times more light falls on us every day than what the human race uses for energy. If we collect 1/10,000th of the daily solar input with solar panels, we can outrun the human race every day with no coal, no oil, no gas, or no nukes. Harvey Wasserman published a book called Solartopia, Looking Back from the Year 2030. That book was published in 2007. And he said, you know, take a trip across the country in a hydrogen-powered airplane in 2030, and we'll stop and visit different places in the country to see what people did with the best technology they had in 2007. People didn't wait for new things to be discovered. They just went with what they had. And the country converted by 2030 to running the country on renewables and hydrogen. And it was they saved a couple trillion dollars in money that wasn't wasted on fossil fuels. That was with the best technology in 2007. Since then, 8 years later, the green alternatives have been getting just cheaper and cheaper and more widespread. Becoming efficient with renewables, solar energy, wind, is our only future, if we have one. If humanity has a future without pushing the planet to a new type of planetary conditions where the sea level comes up about 60 feet, 20 meters in this century because of global warming and climate change, if we're going to avoid that, then the pathway to the future is very clear. We have to have a crash program like what was done to mobilize industry in World War II. They stopped making cars and trucks for a while and started making everything needed to win the war. We had something called the Manhattan Project, where 25,000 people lived in a small city, and they did all the research and created the atomic bomb. And this was done in secret. The rest of the country didn't even know about it. So we can mobilize industry to create and build proper machinery for a national goal if people want to do it. And as the previous speaker mentioned, going green and promoting renewables is not just about saving money on 90-day corporate profits. Just because something is not profitable in a monetary sense doesn't mean that it doesn't make sense to do it. And this is what we're talking about with retrofitting homes. It might be a 10 or a 12 or a 15-year payback on the investment to retrofit a house and cut your energy bills by 90%. But if you do that, you'll save the environment. A home that does that will save the environment hundreds of thousands of pounds of air pollution and water pollution over the life of, you know, the 20-year period. You change one 75-watt light bulb with an 18-watt LED or compact fluorescent. One light bulb will save the atmosphere a ton of pollution over the, you know, the 10,000-hour life of the bulb. They're called 2,000-pound light bulbs. So, you know, a 2,000-pound, one-ton light bulb. Change one bulb in your house, save the atmosphere a ton. Change five bulbs, save 10,000 pounds of air pollution. So those are some of the raw economics that the press does not talk about, because we have ComEd and the gas company that want to keep our consumption up. So we basically keep donating money to the utilities where we wouldn't have to donate that money if we spent it on green alternatives and kept the money in our own bank account. One quick note upon fracking. It's one of the popular myths. I hope Dr. Laura will be talking about this in a month. When we're talking about oil and gas, more and more studies are coming out about the chemicals, the 10,000 different toxic waste chemicals that are used in a toxic mixture of high pressure liquid that's blown down into the fracking wells to crack the stone apart, and the rock, and release natural gas. In 2005, the Cheney administration quietly passed a bill saying that fracking companies would be exempt from the Clean Air and Clean Water Act. That went through Congress during the Bush-Cheney administration because they knew then that fracking was going to destroy the water tables and create a new market for clean water. Fracking is about the new gold rush in clean water. It is not about giving us energy. That's a myth. You know, getting energy out of fracking is much like burning $50 a quart brandy in your car for transportation. You can do it, but it costs way, way, way more than gasoline. The energy you get out of fracking wells is way, way more expensive. When you add it all up, it's more expensive than solar and wind power at today's prices. So this is another thing that is being carefully kept out of the news in America, because if people knew the damage that's done to the water tables and farmers where they can't use the water wells anymore, fracking is a worldwide global disaster. There's no other way to put it. So. Another thing that is never talked about in the press, we published an article a few years ago called, they had the number 10. 10 by 10 by 10. Just remember three tens when you're talking about nuclear power. If you want energy, if you're talking about building nuclear energy for a new source of energy, solar and wind power and renewables can give you 10 times the cost of the energy output of a nuclear plant for one-tenth of the cost per kilowatt hour, and you can get that 10 times as much energy in one-tenth the time it would take to build a nuclear plant. So I tell people, if you like nuclear power, you got to love those pedophile priests. You're in the same moral and ethical standard of people that thought the pedophile priests were doing a good job. You have to have that same kind of mindset to think that nuclear power is good for us or the environment. Nuclear power is a global disaster, an economic disaster, a moral and ethical disaster. Nuclear power is a biological disaster. Fukushima has already cost us roughly 14,000 newborn babies. We've lost 14,000 infant mortality deaths as the cloud from Fukushima drifted over our west coast. The government shut down all the nuclear monitoring stations that the government had, so that the west coast is being monitored by private universities and whoever has private monitoring stations, because that the nuclear disaster in Fukushima is an enormous disaster. So the rest of the world, you get outside the United States, the rest of the world is saying that nuclear power plants are uninsured, uninsurable, they're an economic disaster, and anybody that's promoting them is mired into a level of, how can we put it? A polite term is saying, standing in a blizzard of evidence claiming you can't see a single snowflake. Promoters of nuclear power are like a sports writer that lived in Chicago for 30 years and covered all the sports and says, Michael who? Who's this Michael guy? Michael. Yeah, it was somebody that covered the Vatican for 30 years and claimed I'd never heard of the Pope. That's the essence of the mindset of people that still promote nuclear power of any source, given the fact that they're uninsured, uninsurable, unfinanceable. Nuclear power exists only as a welfare program funded by taxpayers' dollars worldwide, where government extracts money from the taxpayers to pour into the nuclear economic disaster. So Albert Einstein said it best. He said, well, the human race is in a race between education and extinction, and I'm not sure who is winning. And that's where we are today. So the alternatives are very clear. For anybody that wants to read, look at Naomi Klein's new book, This Changes Everything, and look at Professor Griffin's book, Unprecedented. So if anybody wants the information on any of these things, come see me afterwards. I'd be more than happy to give you any information that you might want. Thank you.
Okay, Don.
All right, I thought this was really a good presentation. When I first became interested in the environmental movement way back in the 70s when I was a child, and my parents got me a subscription to Ranger Rick's Nature magazine, the children's magazine of the National Wildlife Federation. And this was like in the mid-1970s and when the so-called energy crisis was going on, and the price of oil went to a dollar a barrel. And there was an article in there for children, aimed at children, talked about alternative sources of energy besides fossil fuels. And from that time forward, I've always been, you know, since then, you know, ever since I was new enough about it, in favor of switching over from fossil fuels to renewable resources. But you know, like solar and wind power, and I think also, now they were against hydroelectric. The National Wildlife Federation was against hydroelectric power, but I'm in favor of it where it's already being used, you know, like already existing dams. Now, one of the problems that I came to realize, it took me a long time to realize this, was that if we were to stop all use of fossil fuels and nuclear energy, the types that environmentalists traditionally dislike, and switch over to renewables, there would be a shortfall. In other words, the demand for electricity is greater, actually a good deal greater, than what can be supplied by renewable energy resources. Now, and this is where concert, and at first I thought, ah, crap, we're doomed. We're going to have to, you know, I mean, we'll have to use nuclear energy or something. I mean, you know, some people talk about nuclear fusion, but that hasn't been invented yet. Maybe it will in the future. But this is where conservation comes in. Basically, what we have to do, now, the consequences of continuing to use fossil fuels, coal, natural gas, and oil, are going to be very bad. Basically, well, we're living with the consequences now. I was just, before the program began, I was talking to Ruth over here, or Ruth was telling me about the fires, the forest fires out west. This is a consequence of the drought, which is in turn is a consequence of the rising temperatures, the greater heat. And so there's more evaporation and less rainfall. And if we're going to, so this global warming thing is very serious. In my opinion, it has the potential to make the Earth unlivable, to make the Earth like the planet Venus, which has an atmosphere very high in carbon dioxide. If we're going to avert these kinds of dire consequences, we've got to get off fossil fuels. We can't just wait to run out of them. But then we run into the new problem, which I just talked about, which is the shortfall between how much energy we can produce using renewables and what the existing demand is. Plus, we have the fact that the demand is likely to get worse, because as the standard of living goes up around the world, people are going to use more electricity. And every advance in technology, and this is going to include the electric cars, when people start using more of them, every new advance in technology increases the demand for electricity, pretty much. All these gadgets, all these electrical appliances we have. This is where conservation comes in. I think we absolutely have got to use conservation, because this way we can bring the demand down till it gets closer to the supply. This would reduce the need to use energy sources other than renewables, you know, such as nuclear energy or whatever, and it would basically make the whole electricity production system much more sustainable. So I think that what this organization, Elevate Energy, is doing is really important and can really make a difference. Now, Ed, you said that our switching off coal in Illinois, or going off of using coal as a power source, was a result of a top-down decision. That is not true. I was actually involved in the Moving Beyond Coal campaign, which is a grassroots campaign that campaigned to get us off coal energy. They made a strategic decision to not tackle all of the fossil fuels at once, but to deal with them one at a time. They decided, okay, coal is the dirtiest source of electricity, so we'll deal with coal first, and then we'll move to the next most destructive sources of energy after that. And it was only because of our campaigning that Illinois is now switching off of the use of coal. Now, I think, Ed, you also mentioned the idea of striking a balance between the economy and the earth. Well, I think that's a false dichotomy, because you don't have an economy without an earth. I mean, let's say if we lose the planet, if we make our own planet, our home, unlivable, there ain't going to be no economy. Okay, you can forget about that. So it's a false idea. So in the long run, there's no question about that. Now, I think Andy made some good points. By the way, Andy has talked about, he mentioned this earlier in the Q&A, he talked about houses that don't require a furnace. I've disagreed with Andy in the past, but on this he's correct, because I used to live in an apartment building where there wasn't any furnaces. The only heat came from from electric heaters. The building was so well insulated that it didn't need anything else. And in fact, I rarely had to use the electric heaters in my apartment, except when it was like, let's say 20 degrees outside, like 10 below freezing or something. But by the way, the Manhattan Project that Andy mentioned actually involved the construction of more than one city. There's actually three cities were constructed pretty much from scratch. Oak Ridge, Tennessee, the Richland, Washington at the Hanford site, and then the third one was Los Alamos in New Mexico. Okay, but anyways, overall good presentation. So,
Mr. Travis.
Good evening. I would like to give you guys all a real good warning. Every time that a so-called community group, community action group or whatever, gets involved in something with certain public utilities, socialist groups that come, that invade the deal to help the people get lower costs and so forth, my experience has been that the more government gets involved in something, the more costs go up. When I was a little boy, my mother could take my sister and I to the doctor, and for $7.50, that was the end of it. But once the government got involved and we started having Medicare and all that sort of thing, it costs you $100 just to go into a doctor's office today. And the same thing with utilities and everything else. Everything the government gets involved in, and the so-called do-gooder socialist organizations that get involved push it in that direction. But I want to say that the answer to high energy costs is right in front of us. Let's not forget about the sodium molten salt reactor. That's the thing that is supposed to really cut down our costs. I think that I always love that. I think that the fracking thing has gone a long way to cut down our costs on natural gas and heating and so forth. And coal, the problem with coal is that we have a president that has regulated the daylights out of it and put all kinds of kibosh things on it to keep coal from being able to be used. He's put thousands of coal miners out of work, and he's caused many coal mining companies to go bankrupt. This is a guy that wants to provide jobs for us. My opinion is to let all the different purveyors of energy compete with one another and let the free market decide on what they will use. And in my opinion, the consumer will get the very best deal. And that is all I have to say tonight.
Great. I'm next after you. I'm next.
All right.
Sodium thorium. Molten salt.
Which doesn't,
you've got
which doesn't
a deli
exist.
That you could have
exist.
Nearby, you'll never lack for salt.
Well, I think there's been as many renewable jobs created with all these stinking windmills and solar panels as there has been coal miners being laid off. Anyway, don't forget, at the end of the month, the real fossil fuel, the bad one, okay. Not coal, going to be talked about here, so you'll learn all you need to know about coal and why it's the bad fossil fuel, much worse than coal.
Talk about oil. You mean oil?
Huh?
You mean oil? It's going to be about
coal or oil?
Yeah.
Did I say oil?
Yes, you said coal.
It's about oil.
It's about oil, but it's not, it's much worse than coal. We go to war for oil, we go to war with oil. Half the deaths in Iraq were oil and gasoline and jet fuel convoys were bombed in Iraq by IUDs or whatever they're called. But anyway, so good point. I think we've become as efficient as we can get as far as natural gas and electricity and heating and lighting, and yeah, there's so much effort been put into that over the last couple of decades that, I mean, you know, we have these light bulbs all changed out. I think we're going to be, we're about as efficient as we're going to get. The only thing bad about coal now is that we're transitioning to all these other renewables, oil, or natural gas, not renewable, but natural gas, wind, and solar, and other things. The problem is the railroads and the coal companies, and probably the Koch brothers, are now exporting coal to other countries. You had the problem here, now it's over here. So, you know, they're clever enough there that they're getting around us getting off of coal. And, you know, I don't think with the people talk about energy and fossil fuels, you got to separate them out. There's natural gas, there's coal, there's nuclear, there's oil. And they all have different issues and different, and there's renewables. But everybody wants to blanket the reporters, the bad media we have in this country now. They say, oh, it's fossil fuel, or it's an energy, or you got to separate them out. I mean, we go to war for oil, like I said. Oil is the one thing we can't really substitute for. I'm wearing my bombs over everything shirt here. Boeing, I mean, there's nothing that they can do to substitute for jet fuel. They really should be getting ahead of the curve and be proactive and maybe be building bullet trains themselves, lemon and some airlines. And eventually jet fuel will be the biggest greenhouse gas, probably several decades from now. But as cars become efficient and we get off of coal and natural gas, jet fuel and its emissions. When we see airplanes overhead, they're very clever with their formulations for jet fuel, and you don't see any smoke, but there's just massive amounts of smoke jet aircraft. So that said, come on by at the end of the month. We'll talk about oil, jet fuel, gasoline, wars, bombs.
I'm next. I'm next.
And Tim is next.
There's no smoke out of the jet engine.
Yeah, it's perfume that comes out of there.
Yep. What's that smoke?
It's emissions. It's all the emissions that are bad. CO2, sulfur dioxide, nitrous dioxide. Soot,
okay.
Name it. They are all the same thing that comes out of a gas pipe or a car pipe, exhaust pipe. Okay, you're a frequent flyer. I know. Sorry.
Next.
Oh.
The only jet engine that the jet engine smokes is broken.
Efficient jet engine.
As much as I keep hearing about the praise of renewables and the panacea that it's going to supply the world's power, according to Andy, I'm a pedophile. I'm a guy who don't look at evidence. I'm a guy who has got his head in the clouds. And you know something, Andy? I will gladly take all those charges, because I feel that nuclear power will save the planet. And I quote you a very simple equation called E equals MC squared. Energy times the speed of light squared produces an awful lot of power. If we went to these Gen 4 thorium reactors, what I would hold in my hand would be what would be required for a man like myself, with all the cars, all the fossil fuels, all the transportation I run, This was all the thorium that would be required to run my high energy lifestyle throughout my entire life, plus an equivalent amount of waste product that would be sequestered for about 400 years. And when you look really at the evidence, we've got right now two economies that are doing it. One is in France, which is about 90% nuclear, and the other is Germany. Huh?
Do you hear about France? I don't want to interrupt.
No, go ahead, tell me about France.
Well, France has announced that they're cutting their nuclear capacity by 50% by 2025. So we should follow the French. We should be getting rid of our nuclear plants. Reducing 50% of their nuclear capacity, shutting it down by 2025. It was just announced.
I'll have to take a look at that.
Please do. Scientific American, please do.
I will. Because the other thing I have been doing is I've been re-examining Andy's evidence to see if there is a glimpse and a hope for solar and wind. Frankly, I'm not seeing it. I will agree that the present day light water reactors that we use are not the best way to do nuclear power. I also know too that we've had in the 1960s a molten salt reactor running for at least 6,000 hours, and we have a lot of the technology now. What needs to happen is deployment. There are about 300 people working on it in China right now, and according to Richard Martin, out of his book called Superfuel Thorium, he believes that this thorium revolution will be coming sooner or later. The other thing that I have to understand is that we are not going to stop the demand of electricity demand growing worldwide. We are not going to stop the development of new power plants coming online. The biggest hope that I see for the world is to get the Generation 4 nuclear plants about the size of this restaurant at atmospheric pressure to get and produce grid power. And even though the smart grid is a good idea, it's still going to take about 50 years to implement over the rest of the world. In France, now they did say they did do this, but in the past they had went from in the 1980s, they went from about 80% coal or whatever, and in less than 11 years, they did convert to about 90% nuclear. Now your information is, I'm going to take a look at it because it's going to be interesting, because when I've been looking in Germany, there's been a lot of talk recently from some other sources that they want to restart some of their plants so they don't have to build new coal ones. And still, coal is the largest provider of electricity worldwide and growing. Robert Hargreaves wrote a book called Thorium Cheaper Than Coal. He details a good solid design for a thorium molten salt reactor that could fit on the back of a tractor trailer truck. He could show you how we could mass produce these things in factories and bring them online cheaper than the rest of the world. And in looking at the evidence, particularly through John Kutch and his organization and others, I'm more convinced than ever that we need this. The other reason that I really think we're not going to be doing away with a big time central delivered power is because when you look at the internet and our data centers, for example, they're now used roughly 8% of the world's electricity grids. And if you took all the power that would come out of Hoover Dam, they would only power up about 4 of these massive data centers. Now, granted, they use a lot of renewable technology. They locate them in cool areas. They locate them in a lot of other places where they use cooling and solar and all this stuff. But they still use an awful lot of power to keep the computers running. And they have to have this power on demand. And every one of them has a backup diesel generator. Every wind farm has a backup natural gas generator. And when I looked at some studies done by other places, the constant starting and stopping of these gas peaking plants actually produces more power than to keep them running continuously, variable on an up and down cycle, and it almost seems like the wind was an aggregate deal in here. The point is, nuclear power is already providing some 40%, I'm sorry,
no,
some 20%, right, of our power in the United
That's
Kingdom.
Less than that now. Plants are being shut down.
And a lot more will be shut down
nuclear
in the next 10 years.
Nuclear relapse.
Let's hurry up and do it.
Well, if you want to see a rise in coal and a rise in fossil fuel use, that's exactly what's going to happen
no
when
won't.
You shut them down.
Yeah. No, it won't.
Do it tomorrow.
Well, I think you guys are absolutely, I'm sorry, but I have to respectfully disagree.
Yeah.
I respectfully disagree because of the data and because of some things I have looked at myself online.
What about the Fukushima? You looked at that online?
Fukushima was a bad design put down by the ocean, and they didn't have the breakwaters high enough to keep the plant from shutting down. The thing is, too, also when you look at the other major disaster, which was Chernobyl, there was no reactor shielding on it. Again, it was a poorly engineered design. That reactor in Chernobyl was made for one purpose, the production of plutonium for bombs. And when it got a fire, it blew up because of, again, a very poor reactor design. Now, the one I will give us credit for is when we had was Three Mile Island. There was some radiation escape, but it still was not this devastating thing they caused. 1979 was a very poor year for nuclear power because just a couple weeks before, they had that movie that came out. What's it called?
The China Syndrome.
And it was less than 2 weeks later that the Three Mile Island disaster happened.
That's right.
So, you know, you talk about two black eyes for an industry. Yes, I agree. And yes, I do agree that in the present form, the light water reactor is not the best way to do nuclear. There are better ways of doing nuclear. The problem is we haven't innovated. We haven't done basic research into the reactors. We haven't really done anything. It's sort of like running our computers now on Windows 3.1 and not modernizing for 20 years and trying to run a modern internet site on it. No, I prefer E equals MC squared any day over renewables. Thank you.
Our illustrious organizer.
Okay, Charlie, when you're ready.
Charlie, you
only are. All right, let's see, where do I begin? All right, I watched the Congress debate the new energy policy. And they kept reiterating, these Republicans who control the both houses of Congress, and they kept saying this, and the chairman of the committee kept repeating this, that we get 85% of our energy from coal, oil, and natural gas.
Yep.
And they are actually opposed to, and I won't go into detail, they actually are opposed to alternative energy. They really are. They won't give it any concept, any discussion whatsoever here. I'll jump around and be eclectic as usual here. Regarding the coal thing, now, even the railroads in the 19th century recognized the deposits of coal in the United States, particularly the Wyoming Basin. And they actually competed for the rights to build those railroads even then, because they knew the potential. And you were saying there that well, you made some argument for natural gas. The railroads built first. The first thing that happened was they built the Dakota, Minnesota, and Eastern Railroad, which was a little short line, a regional line, and
invested, the railroads invested as much money in this little railroad line that went to those Wyoming coal deposits as it cost to build the entire transcontinental railroad. They also purchased some things that took place. The Union Pacific purchased the Northwestern. And right now you have a four-track mainline going in and out of coal fields. That's very, very rare. There are very few four-track mainlines. Actually, I can only think of maybe one, possibly outside of a city. You have one here in Chicago. That's what I mean. And you have trains. That means you have two trains going in each direction all day. Do you realize how much coal this is? I mean, it's just, and these are 100, 125 car trains.
Where's it going?
And he's saying, well, you're using natural gas. That's how much energy we're using. And the administration was trying to get away from this coal usage. This scale is just unbelievable. And they were saying, well, you're job killers in the states of West Virginia and Pennsylvania. They were griping about it, and Kentucky in particular, West Virginia. We didn't have anything to do with it. And they have large Republican delegations. So the alternative energy people had no place to go in this. They weren't getting any action whatsoever. There wasn't even, I could tell you some more stories. They wouldn't, any amendment you had that regarded any amendment, even the simplest amendment to the energy legislation that advanced alternative energy was defeated, not even voted on. It never got out of committee. It was zapped immediately. These guys are in the pocket of the energy corporations, and they are solid. Oil, coal, and gas. And the other thing they were looking for was to start more, amazingly enough, despite these leaks we've had, the other legislation that they were looking for was to do more offshore oil drilling. This is where their heads are. Yeah. They are not conservative. They are not going to listen to greenies out there. But anyhow, that's the coal thing. We covered that. I'm sorry, my friend. Technology is not the solution. Education is not the solution to everything. Technology is not the solution. More technology and we'll be wonderful. Life will be wonderful. You know, just like Dr. Zarkov can make any kind of device you want on demand.
Is not technology?
You know, but it's not a solution. No, as a matter of fact, she was talking here as conservation.
Yes. It's all admired.
She didn't talk about solar panels.
Okay, but that's
she
not technology.
Be realistic of what you're using.
That's
and let me
technology.
Tell you, all she was saying is do an inventory, a personal inventory, of our current energy usage. And that is not even low tech is what she was talking about, if anything. Insulation. And I'll be honest with you, I haven't done it myself. The people's gas has this thing. They'll come in and insulate your water pipes, things of that nature. Which can be taken advantage of. And what she was saying, these other things, I doubt if there is very many homes at all. Now let me tell you where I'm coming from on this. Many, many years ago, I published for the government of the United States a green building reference book. In particular, it was brand new, Internet Reference Sources. And this was in conjunction with the Public Building Service. The government has 6,800 buildings. I was ahead of the curve on this. Green building technology. You know how many copies I could sell? Zero. No one was interested in this. They didn't care. No one paid much attention. They thanked me for the publication and so forth. A few years later, I was at a conference, and everybody and their brother was to get green credentials as an architect or an engineer. I finally came around. But let me tell you, at the beginning of it, green building technology, and I still doubt very much that most homeowners and even building managers have really done an assessment of their structures and done what they can. Sometimes it's difficult because you're doing renovation work And it's not like new construction. If you have new construction, you can use the state of the art. But when it's retrofit, it's a whole different thing. And I actually know a little bit about this topic. Technology's not going to be it. It's not some miracle technology. Matter of fact, this technology is not even one that I would recommend, given the potential hazards and the level of technology that's required. If anyone has any familiarity with a nuclear reactor, it was that these are not simple little devices. These are not. Now, the other thing, I'll tell you the story, and I've told this for many years, every Earth Day we used to have Ed Ponder come here and speak. And he was working on a magical machine, the magic machine that you could take and you could throw, remember, you could throw old car seats in or an old couch into his machine, and would go yada, 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 turn it on and crank around. And then out at the other end, there'd be a pipe and you could have gasoline and put it right into your car. He had two, he told me he was working on the larger scale model version, an industrial version, but he was hoping to have a home unit so you could produce your own gasoline. I guess you could go up and down the alley and find stuff and who knows what, or tear down your neighbor's fence and produce gasoline, you know. Needless to say, he actually abandoned it, and then he had some new high-tech projects for energy. And I never wanted to ask, I always wanted to ask him, what happened to the machine, you know? Because now he was going into other technology, because that one didn't work, it then ended. What happened? You know, they could never get it operational. What we really got to do is get serious about this. And I mean, and I was not serious about energy conservation and use in my own house. I got to self-discipline myself, maybe because I can afford to pay the bills. If I couldn't, it would be a serious issue, or if the bill was enormous. You know what always amazes me? I see these suburban homes, these enormous suburban, how do they heat and cool those palaces? It's just enormous. It's because I don't have much of a living space, and I pay a considerable amount. But the scale, the square footage of these places, it's just, I can't fathom. Do they have that much money that you could spend it on? I really don't like spending money on energy, because I don't think you get anything in return, you know, at least material-wise. But I think one of the things we gotta look at, we gotta get serious about this, and the Greens gotta get together, is we got to nationalize the energy. Because we've tried the private sector approach, and they're just making money, they're stealing us money from each of us, whether it be the coal, the oil, or the natural gas people. They are just taking whatever they can get. Greed has consumed them. There's no energy policy. The only policy they're concerned with is how much profit they can get. In your free market, there is it in its purest form. They have no desire, they have no concerns whatsoever of the consequences of burning fossil fuels. It's nonsensical to burn anything any longer and to think that nothing's going to happen to the atmosphere. But they are making money. And you are not going to have any policy enacted unless the people get together, that is going to interfere with their making money. I'm lobbying an issue on these crude oil tank cars. We're going to have the thing in August. I'm going up against the petroleum industry. Don't you think I know what I'm dealing with? Do you think they listen to me? Perhaps they do, if I can present a certain argument that relates to their specific locality. It takes some doing, but they've been purchased. They've been purchased by these guys. And we're letting them control not only the economy of this nation, it's probably the economy of the world. And if you want to talk about multinationalism, this is a global thing. And Andy talks about this all the time. What is the true cost of a gallon of gasoline? I think it's like
$40 if you really computed everything.
No, you haven't.
We've got to nationalize the energy sources that we use in this nation. This is something that is prime for nationalization, whether they already have this in certain communities. It was a mistake in the beginning to allow private utilities to, they are monopolies, and they are ones we should take control over in the name of the people. Just nationalize them, say thanks. They've made enough money. We'll pay them nothing. I wouldn't pay them. I wouldn't give them 10 cents. I'd say, just, you're done. Goodbye, go. We don't need you anymore. And administer this energy policy like we should. This is a community shared thing that is a natural community entity that lends itself, and it's an inherent function of government to take control over this. All right, thanks a lot. Take care. And come back to the other ones.
Doing your noob stuff. You getting up there, Professor?
Yeah, I'm off.
What does Jesus say about it? Jesus, he's...
That's what we should be
is talking about. Sin?
Now, Charlie has told us that the people who are making money today out of the oil industry, the coal industry, the gas industry, and the delivery systems, ComEd and People's Gas and all the rest, that they're eating money and wages and everything that we shouldn't be affording. That life could be a whole lot better.
Thank
if
you,
we shared.
I appreciate it.
Well, yes. Yes, there are terrible costs to the capitalist system.
And
if you let capitalist class rule you, you're going to suffer the consequences. The question is, who's going to be better? And how, what is it to be better? What kind of pressures and incentives and so on will the replacement for these capitalists be? The Russians tried a system of state capitalism where the people who ruled were even less responsible to the people, and it failed. It failed economically, it failed socially, it was oppressive, and it failed to compete with the private capitalist system. It doesn't mean that either the private capitalist system or the state capitalist system are the optimum. What is the kind of society, what is the kind of humanity that you look for? Jesus shows us something of the way. The kind of incentives that really make you more human, more what is more natural. Natural is not always good. It's natural to die, and dying isn't a plus all the time. Jesus made a plus out of it himself by using his death to show the way to be honest and to be faithful to the love that he had for the rest of humanity. If we can find out what kind of relationships we're going to have and look for, we talk about democratic, egalitarian, more solidarity and so on, the kind of interrelationships that we'd like to have. Jesus was a path maker in this, and I expect I'll be hearing about him next week.
All right.
Great.
Praise
Jesus. Couple of announcements. One announcement real quick. In the Illinois Train Museum tomorrow, they're having an extravaganza where they're having a lot of vintage cars, a lot of vintage rail, and they're having a lot of their rail stock come out. Now, I know I live out in Algonquin, but if you're wanting to come out to Union, Illinois, to the Illinois Train Museum, Illinois Railway Museum, you might find it to be a very good outing. They're going to have a lot more out than they normally will. That's all I got to say.
Okay. Hey, Tim, I wanted to say something.
Please.
Look, there was something that I forgot to say in my rebuttal speech. And that is, look, Ed and the others who talked about the financial disincentives to engage in conservation, short-term disincentives, that's basically true, I think. I mean, this is the reason why a lot of property owners don't do it, homeowners or owners of real estate. But I think conservation, nevertheless, is vitally important. I think one thing we can do, Ellen suggested, or she asked if there were tax incentives. I think I don't know how much Illinois is doing this now, but I think this would be an excellent way to encourage people to conserve more by offering tax incentives to property owners to weatherize their buildings. That would encourage more of that. That's all I wanted to say about it.
Why don't you close us out, Don?
Oh, okay. All right. Well, I don't know what to say to close out the College of Complexes, except thank you for coming and good night.
Where's our speaker? Thank you.
She left.